So hi everyone, welcome to our second class. Today we'll talk about more complex data structures in Prolog. So we'll talk about structures first. So if you remember from last time, we talked that in Prolog, it's a very weakly typed language. It has atoms, which are basically symbols within single quotes or symbols that start with lowercase letters and contain only digits, letters, and underscore. Then we also have numeric types like integer and floating point numbers and variables. And finally, we have structures, which are very useful for any kind of algorithm that requires collections. Basically, we need a list of the elements of the collection and we need to iterate through the list and apply some function to those elements or prove something for a collection of elements. So, but lists are just a syntactic sugar that internally gets transformed into structures. Structures are the most general term. Basically, a list would be just internally kept like it's kept in functional languages as the head and the rest of the list. So it's actually a functor that has two parameters, the head or the first element, and the rest of the list. So in our case, we start with general structures. So a general structure has a functor, which is an identifier, and the arguments of that functor. In this case, T1 to Tn are all terms, so they can be themselves other structures or atoms or numbers or variables. So you can see it as the functor applied to the arguments, which in turn, they can also be other functors applied to other arguments. In all of these notations for logic programs, F is called the functor and TIs are called arguments. And structures are used to group together terms or other items in basically the same way that in C we have structures and objects in Java. So structures can be used to construct trees. In a special case, they can construct lists with a special functor symbol. For instance, if we want to represent that an expression E is this expression, is binary plus symbol applied to minus of unary tree and unary number 1 and multiplication between number 4 and number 2, we would have to represent that tree as a parse tree. And we can see that in Prolog, we can represent it as a structure plus applied to inner structures, basically smaller structures for the left tree and the right tree. Data structures may have variables, and the same variable may occur multiple times in a data structure. So for instance, here we have two data structures, one in which we have variables x and y, and we can represent them as putting basically x here and y here, or another in which we have twice the variable x. So as you can see, we have basically the variable x will occur multiple times. And this can be unified with other data structures or with variables. So here we have that E is unified with this data structure. Okay. So this actually helps us when we call a method or a procedure or a predicate in Prolog. We basically unify that the query with the head of that rule. And this unification is it's also called matching in the procedural meaning of Prolog. And it will basically unify variables with their values. So matching is this operation that takes two terms. One may be a variable or a structure or a number and unifies the two structures. So it finds substitutions for the variables that occur in those terms that make those two terms identical. And later we'll introduce the logical operation corresponding to matching called unification, which has a logical semantics. So here we have an example of matching. We have a structure plus of minus number 3 and number x with number y, with star of number y, number 2, with Another structure that also has the same binary symbol, binary functor plus, then it applies to minus between number 3 and number 1 and star of number 4 and number 2. So basically, this will try to match the two trees. And the matching algorithm is that if the functor symbol is the same, then we will match the children. So it will match the left child, minus with minus is the same arity, two arguments, number 3, number x, with number 3, number 1. This succeeds only if x is unified with 1. And then star on the right-hand side of number y and number 2, number 4 and number 2, it will unify y with 4. So actually, this is a Prolog query that will succeed only if x is unified with 1 and y is unified with 4. Okay? So it will basically, you can think of object-oriented language that matches structures, and it will basically substitute the variables with their corresponding values in the tree. So let's see some more examples of matching before we actually write an algorithm that does this matching for us. Two constants match if they have the same value. So for instance, 42 matches only with the constant 42. Doesn't match with any other constant. Similarly for symbols. You have, let's say, pole. It only matches pole. Prolog and most logic programming languages have this unique name assumption. Basically, it means that a symbol can only match with itself, nothing else. Then a variable matches with anything by unifying that variable with that value. So if we have A matches with 35, then from this point on, A is 35. If we have two variables, a variable matches with another variable, then the two variables become associated. Basically, it means that even if later we match the one of the variables with the value, the other variable becomes the same. So you can think of references. What it means when A matches B, in a language like C, it would mean that A and B are actually a location that has the same reference. Internally, it's actually stored on a stack. So there are basically links between A and B, and also the moment that any one of them becomes a value like 35, the other one also becomes the same. And this is actually has also logical semantics, that if you have a conjunction, the conjunction is commutative. So it doesn't matter that you assign a value later, it also means that now both variables are matched to the same value. So now we can actually come with an algorithm for matching. Two structures match if they have the same functor and the same arity, the same number of arguments. And they match recursively. That means that now the left tree matches, or the first argument with the first argument of the second structure, the second argument with the second argument, and so on. Third argument with third, and so on. So for instance, if we would want to match foo of g of 42 and 37 with foo of a and 37, first thing that we do, we compare the functors. Foo binary functor with foo binary functor is the same. Then g of 42 with a. This succeeds by binding a to g of 42. And then 37 with 37 matches. So now this will succeed with A bound to G of 42. But we can also try to match foo of G of 42 and 37 with foo of G of A and B. And that succeeds with A bound to 42 and B bound to 37. So the general algorithm for matching is that two terms, S and T, match as follows. If they are both constants, then S match with T succeeds if and only if both are the same constant object. If s is a variable and t is anything, then it succeeds by actually binding this variable with that second thing. If t is a variable and s is anything, again it succeeds by matching that variable with the other structure. And this includes when they are both variables, now the two become associated. If s and t are structures, the functors, then we check S matches T if and only if S and T have the same functor, the same arity, and all their corresponding arguments also match. And we get also the substitutions for variables. So I have here a bigger example. Basically, the structure on the left-hand side matches the structure on the right-hand side if X matches 1 and Y matches 4. And the reason why I put the variables on the left-hand side is to actually see the fact that this is not assignment. It's really matching. So it doesn't matter that the variables are here and not here. It's a matching succeeds if it binds the variables to unique values. So for instance, if I have X twice in the second structure, this will fail because X cannot be bound at the same time with 1 and with 4. So we can now basically write tests to see what matches what. So for instance, which of these match? If we try to match A with 100, it will succeed by matching A with 100. If we match A with func of B, it succeeds with A bound to func of a variable, and that variable being B. And basically this continues, and we can see that if we compare everything with everything in the list, we have that A matches everything. 100 matches A, and that's it, because 100 does not match these structures that start with func. It said that a structure can only match a variable or another structure with the same functor and arity, and then recursively the arguments. So 100 only matches A, func of B matches A, func of 100, and func of plus 99 and 1. Now, you would say, does func of 100 match func of plus 99 and 1? And the answer is no, because expressions are not evaluated in prologue. In prologue, functors have no meaning. They are basically just groupings of, this is the function name, and these are the arguments of that. So func of plus 99 and 1 would match the variable A and func of B, but it will not match func of 100 because this thing is not evaluated. Unless we are actually using a special built-in predicate in prologue that evaluates it. It's called is. You would say X is and an expression, then it will evaluate that arithmetic expression. But without that, it will not evaluate it. We'll see an example later. So for instance, how is this useful? It's useful that because you could access structures by using variables. So for instance, if you want to extract from a date like January 1st, 2020, the month, the day, and the year, you would use unification, or internally when you call a predicate, it will do this unification for you. Basically the query with the head of rules that match the same predicate. So basically if you only want the day, not only not the month and the year, you would use anonymous variables. And then the matchings will happen, but they are not going to be returned when we return from that query. So prologue uses a special syntax for lists because lists are common in any kind of programming languages, especially in prologue. And that is the notation with open close bracket. It represents the list that contains the elements 1, 2, 3, 4 in this case. And this can also be written in the internal representation of prologue. So the internal representation of prologue, it keeps the head of the list and the tail of the list. I will show it to you in a second here. Basically, list is just a special case of a functor, which is period. And period is basically a binary functor that keeps the head of the list, in this case 1, and the tail of the list is also a structure stored in the same way. So basically, it keeps the head of that list, which is 2, and the tail, which is a list, the rest of the list. Now, you would say that this is exactly the same way that a functional language like SML has head and tail for every list. And list has CDR and CAR for every list and so on. Yes, with one exception. In Prolog, you can have in front of that pipe symbol, basically the separator between the head and the tail, any number of arguments. So yes, it's true that you can write 1, 2, 3 as the list that contains as head 1 and the tail 2, 3, 4, but you can also write it as the list that starts with 1, 2 and the tail 3, 4. So the difference between Lisp or SML and Prolog is that in Prolog, the head doesn't have to be just the first element. It's the prefix of that list. So we can get the first 2 elements in a short notation. Instead of basically, you can get the first 3 elements, even the first 4 elements, and then the empty list would be the tail. Any questions? Exactly like this. So all of those are actually the same one. The list 1, 2, 3, the list that starts with 1 as the head and the tail 2, 3, 4. The list that starts with 1 and the tail is the list that starts with 2 and the tail is 3, 4. Or the list that starts with 1, 2, 3 and the rest of the list is 4 and so on. Basically, the only thing that this pipe operator does, it separates the prefix, the beginning of the list, with the rest of the list. Exactly. Internally, everything is stored this way. As a functor period, it's a predefined functor, binary functor, which has the head of the list and the tail. And this is completely like invisible for us. The truth is that it also uses a special symbol for empty list. It's called nil, which in this case, I just used the empty list. I didn't want to overload with another symbol. But it's like null at the end of a structure. Okay, but there is an advantage to that. So in, let's say, functional languages, at the end of the list, you have nil. But in Prolog, you can have a variable at the end of the list. So why is that useful? If you want to add elements at the end of the list, if you have that variable, you can just create a new tree with the new element and a tail, which is another variable. Those are basically lists that end in variables. So you can add elements at the end of the list. Okay. Any questions? Okay. Strings, they are also available in Prolog. They are sequences of characters within double quotes. And they are equivalent with the list of numeric character codes of that string. So they are basically used for, let's say, natural language processing. You can basically break the string into characters. So you can do parsing and other, basically, NLP algorithms. But if you want just the symbol, you shouldn't use lists. Lists are quite heavy because it keeps that entire symbol as a list of characters. So it depends on the kind of application that you're implementing. If you don't need to break this string into characters, you should keep it as a symbol within single quotes or just as the identifier ABC because it starts with lowercase letter. If you want to do any kind of string manipulations, that you should use double-quoted strings. But remember the fact that internally they are stored as lists, so they are a little bit heavy because even in imperative languages, strings usually are stored in a symbol table or they are interned. They keep a single copy of the string without having to create multiple copies when it does any kind of string manipulation. So let's start writing programs. Yeah. List. Oh, they are possible. As the elements of the list, you can have anything you want. So the elements of the list, they are just terms. In this here in every one of these elements, you can have other lists. You can have the period functor and then its arguments, head and tail and so on. Okay. And this is just the internal representation, because let's actually start programming. Let's change to the desktop. You can have X is the list that contains the list 1, 2, 3, and the list, let's say 4, 5, 6. So it's a double list, or you can have, let's say, here you have the list that contains 5, 6, and here we have just an element 7. So, and lists in prog don't have to be homogeneous. You can have atoms, you can have variables anywhere you want. In this case, I even created an infinite list because I use x is this, and now I replace x here with the list that contains the list 1, 2, x, and the rest. So by mistake, because I typed x, I wanted to show an example that you have a variable in this structure, I created an infinite structure. But really what I wanted is that you in structures like lists, you can have variables. So in this case, the list x is the list that contains the list 1, 2, and a variable a placeholder y, and then another list that contains 4 and the list s 6 and the element a. So now later I can actually say, and y is bound to something else, maybe the list that contains 7, 8, and z. So now I have the original list A, x is 1, 2, the list that contains 7, 8 instead of y, and another placeholder, and so on. And as I said before, this doesn't have to be before we actually, or after we define x. We can actually have y is bound earlier, like y is, let's say, bound to z, and later we have, and z is bound to 12. Now, x and y and z are linked together to 12, and x is the list that contains this element with y replaced with 12. Any questions? Okay. Let's move this a little bit to the right, because we'll write a lot of such examples. Okay. So, let's program with lists. So, for any program that you will ever write, mainly the predicates that you would need are member, append for concatenating lists. You may have set operations like union, intersection, difference, reverse of the list in reverse order, flattening of a list. Like, for instance, the previous list of lists that we had, we can flatten it to one level. Like, basically, every single inner list just use the elements in the outer list. So we start with member, and actually this shows us the power of prolog, because it shows us that prolog is not functional. You can call it with is to a member of this, and it will respond yes, and if it's not a member, it will respond no, but you can also call it with a variable, in which case it will reply that x can be L, can be I, can be S, or can be T. But first, let's take a look at the predicate definition. So an element is a member of a list if it's the head of the list. Or an element is a member of a list if it's a member of the tail of that list. So the first example said that x is the head of the list, and we don't care what's the tail. Definitely, if x is the head of the list, then x is a member of that list. The second one says that x is a member of a list of whatever head, I don't care, if it's a member in the tail of that list, ys. So this actually has two features. One is that If I call it with bound elements, it will respond yes or no. Basically, if it's if 2 is the head of the list, then it will respond yes. If it's not, it will try the second rule, and it will call if 2 is a member of the tail of the list, in this case 2, 3, which calls recursively the same predicate and now says yes, because 2 is the head of the tail of the list. But it, you can also call it with is X a member of the list that contains the identifiers L, I, S, T, in which case the first rule will tell us that yes, if X is L. The second rule will tell us yes, if X is a member of the tail of the list, which now recursively will succeed for X matched with I, or X a member of the tail of the rest of the list, which basically now will return that X could also be S or S could be T. So through backtracking, it gives me all the possible solutions. Similarly, in this case, if we ask if F of X is a member of the list that contains F of 1, G of 2, F of 3, and H of 4, will succeed twice with X bound to 1 and X bound to 3. What do you think that will return the last predicate? Is X member of a list that is a variable? So in this case, the first rule will tell us that 1, this is the number 1, is a member of a list that starts with 1 and has any tail, any rest of the list. But then it will go to the second definition and will say that X is also a member of that list that starts with any element and X is a member of the tail, which succeeds with X being the head of the list or X being in the tail of the list. So this will return all the lists that contain 1. The list that starts with 1, the list that has as the second element 1, the list that has as the third element 1, and so on. It will actually construct all the lists with placeholders for the rest of the elements, which has 1 in the first element, second, third, fourth, and so on. So let's actually see this. So we are going again like we did it last time. I'm going to create a new text document and let's call it a.pl. And let's increase the size so everybody can see this. So we said that the definition is that X is a member of any list that starts with X and has any tail. And X is a member of any list that starts with any element and the tail YS if X is a member of the tail YS. Okay, so now we can load that program A and we can ask is, let's say, 3 member of the list 1, 2, 3, 4. And Prolog will say yes. And now we can ask, is X a member of 1, 2, 3? And it will tell us yes, if X is 1, if X is 2, if X is 3, or if X is 4. And now we can ask, is 1 an element of the list L? And it will tell us yes, if the list L starts with 1, or the list L has at least two elements, any number actually, where the second element is 1, or the list has 3 elements and the third element is 1, or has 4 elements or more and the fourth element is 1, and so on. And if I keep pressing semicolon, there is an infinite number of such lists. It's not that interesting at this point because member is just usually used for checking membership. But we will see that it's very interesting for append because we can call append of X, Y, and the result is the list 1, 2, 3, 4, and it will give us back all the pairs of two lists which concatenated are the list 1, 2, 3, 4. So let's start first with the definition. So when we define any predicate in Prolog, we have to think recursively. Because we have to find what's the base case, when do we stop concatenating the two lists, and what is the recursive case. So in the first case, it says that concatenating the empty list with the list L gives us the list L. Otherwise, we break the first list into the head of the list X and the rest of the list, the tail of the list L, and concatenate it with a list M gives us a list that starts with the same X and a tail N, if appending the tail L with the second list M gives us the tail N. So recursively, it says that if in the begin in the first list I have more elements, now the result will be the first element with the tail that is the result of concatenating the rest of the list, in this case 2 with 3, 4. And that will basically return as the second element 2, and then it will call append the rest of that list with 3, 4, which will succeed in the base case and will say the rest of the list is 3, 4. So appending 1, 2 with 3, 4 returns 1, 2, 3, 4. But the good part, and this is the difference why this is not functional programming or no imperative programming, is that it's a theorem prover. It will actually also say that, yes, I can prove that appending X with Y is 1, 2, 3, 4 if X is the empty list and Y is the list 1, 2, 3, 4, or if the first element was a list that starts with 1, and let's say the list 1, and the tail of that list concatenating with Y is 2, 3, 4. But one case there is that the tail is empty, and then the list Y is 2, 3, 4. So it will tell us that 1 concatenated with 2, 3, 4 is 1, 2, 3, 4. And recursively, we return all the pairs of two lists whose concatenation is 1, 2, 3, 4. So let's again repeat this. So I'm going to implement append of the empty list with the list L is the list L. This is the base case. And append of a list that contains at least one element, H, with a tail T, with another list, let's call it M, is a list that starts with X and has a tail, let's say T, no, T2, why not T2? If concatenating the tail T with M is the tail T2. Excellent. So let's save it, recompile in Prolog. And now it tells us that we have singleton variables. Let's see what we missed. So here is fine, and here we have H. Ah, yes. This should be H. So the head is there, the tail, the middle list, and the tail, the other tail is fine. So you see that singleton variables help to see if I didn't mistype something. So now append of 1, 2, 3 with 4, 5 is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and nothing else. And what list appended with what other list gives me 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So X, Y gives me 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And that tells me that there are 6 possibilities. If I append the empty list with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, gives me the list 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If I append the list 1 with the list 2, 3, 4, 5, gives me the list 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If I append 1, 2 with 3, 4, 5, gives me that same list, and so on, up to if I append the list 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 with empty, gives me the list 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it gives me through recursion all the pairs, and I can take one result or I can take all results, depending on what do I want to do with it. So a predicate is not a function. It's in Prolog, we actually are doing theorem proving. So we can leave any variable unbound and we would actually get what is a true fact that we can prove about that specific predicate. So in this case, appending the list L with the list 2, 3 is the list 1, 2, 3 if the list L is the list that contains 1. If we call append with the list 1 and L and gives us the result list 1, 2, 3, this is only possible if the list L is 2, 3. And this is the middle case, the case where these two are both unbound and gives me all the solutions. So what happens internally? I mean, we can trace it. We know the program. The program is basically this program that we have here. And we can ask a query. What happens when we call append of 1, 2, and 3, 4? So this basically, we'll try first to match it with the first case. But the first case fails immediately because the empty list does not match a list that contains 1, 2. So, but the second case succeeds. We match append of 1, 2, and 3, 4 into the variable A. Will match X as the head of the list with 1, L with the tail of that list, which is the list that contains 2, M with the list 3, 4, A with this list that starts with X, which is 1, and the tail is N. So now it calls append of the tail of the first list. So it calls append of 2 with 3, 4, with the value n, which was the tail of the head of the first rule. And now it does exactly the same thing. First, it tries to match the first rule, but again, it cannot because the list that contains 2 does not match the empty list. So it matches the second rule, and x being the head of the list is matched to 2, l is matched to empty list, m is matched with the list 3, 4, and we call append of the empty list and 3, 4. Which, again, there is only one rule that matches that case, which is the first case. And now we know that n prime is the list 3, 4. So now we go back, and we know that n is 2 followed by 3, 4 as the tail, and a is 1 followed by 2, 3, 4. So we get the final answer that a must be the list 1, 2, 3, 4. When we run trace, we get exactly this, like step by step what happens. And why do we get the answers that we get? So let's talk about another predicate, length. So the length of a list is the number of elements of that list. A beginner programmer in Prolog would write these rules. So it will say that the length of the empty list is 0, and the length of the list that starts with any element as the first element and excess as the rest elements is n plus 1. If the length of the tail excess is n. So this will work. If we ask length of empty list, it says 0. If we ask is length of the list that has 4 elements 4, it will say no, it's false. And then we ask another query, what is it? And it will tell us is x, where x is the plus operation between 0, 1, 1, 1, 1. So what we see here is that it didn't evaluate because, as I said earlier, a functor is just a functor. So in Prolog, if you would want to run this is 1 plus 2, 3, it will tell false. And the reason is that in predicate logic, symbols have no meaning beside basically being a predicate itself. So equal has no meaning. It doesn't evaluate 1 plus 2. So, in particular, any function symbol like 1 plus 2 are not interpreted in any way. So, for that, we use a built-in predicate in Prolog, is. So, is has a special feature. It says an expression is another expression, e. E will be evaluated. Now we know that that is an arithmetical expression. And once we evaluate e, we will try to match R from the left-hand side of that is with the value of that expression. So for instance, if we would write x is 1 plus 2, it will succeed and binds x to 3. If we write 3 is 1 plus 2, succeeds because 1 plus 2 evaluates to 3. And now it matches 3 with 3, which succeeds. But what happens if on the on the right-hand side we have a variable that was never instantiated with any value? It will give us an error. It will tell us that I cannot evaluate x plus 3. I need a value for x. So if this occurs before we bind x with anything, it will be basically a crash. It will tell us that it cannot be evaluated. But at least this is predicate gives us a way to write length. So now length requires that we basically compute the length of the tail of the list, and then we use that length in this expression n plus 1, and we assign, we basically bind the value of m to a list that has one more element than the tail. So now we have again the two base fact. The base fact, we have the length of the empty list is 0, and the length of a list that starts with one element and has a tail xs is the length of that tail plus 1. So it will succeed for length of a list of 4 elements with 4. It will also succeed for the length of 4 elements with a value for a variable x equal with 4, if basically because it evaluates the length of the tail to 3 and the length of that tail to 2 and so on. It will also generate lists. Like for instance, if I want a list with 4 elements and those are unbound variables, I can call length of list and 4, in which case it generates a list with 4 placeholders. And the values that you have here are just placeholders. In fact, you're getting a list with 4 locations, variables. And now you can actually assign values to those locations. In Prolog, you also have a conditional operator. But again, it's just a syntactic sugar, because internally is translated into, if A succeeds, then I try to prove B. If A fails, so I can use the negation of A, then go on to prove C by ignoring B. It's useful for deterministic predicates like maximum. I pass in 2 values that are definitely bound to values, like 1 and 2. It checks if x is less than or equal with y, the maximum will be bound to y. Otherwise, the maximum is bound to x. So here, in this expression, I'm actually using the standard operators and the priorities between operators. Basically, conjunction has the highest priority. Disjunction has lower priority than that. And implication has the same priority with disjunction. So why is this useful? Because I could write also a factorial. And in factorial, I want this part here to be bound together. So it's if n is greater than 0, then I compute the factorial of n1, which is n minus 1, into f1, and the factorial is n multiplied with f1. Otherwise, if n is less than or equal with 0, then the factorial is declared to be 1. Factorial is only defined for positive numbers. So factorial of 12 will be computed recursively. But really, this notation that is accepted for if then else is just a syntactic sugar. It internally gets translated into if this is true, then execute this. If this is false as a second rule, then execute this. So this is an imperative feature, which later we'll see that we can also have another feature called cut, which basically says that in Prolog and in logic programming, it tries all the rules. But what if I don't want to try all the rules? If a guard, basically a prefix of the rule is correct, I want to declare this is the only option. So cut will basically say that from here on, I will not backtrack. So we learned earlier that we do this backtracking. We have to think of every program in Prolog being executed forward and then backwards. But if we don't want to backtrack, if we succeed and we don't want to backtrack, we use a special symbol in Prolog, exclamation sign, it's like a predicate, but it says to the interpreter, do not backtrack anymore. We'll see it later. These are both basically non-imperative features of prologue. So you can think of like writing a program in prologue, and then you would want to fail to get other answers and print all the solutions, but and as I said, cut is, we'll see it later. So in addition to that, there are many built-in predicates. If you look at the end of the lecture notes, which we'll probably not get to today, there are ways to modify the database with asserts and retracts. There are ways to read from files and write to files with open, close, tell, and see, which allows us basically to read and write content to files. There are also predicates to query the rules in the database, close, which basically gives us the head and the body of any rule that we have in the database. There is another predicate that allows us to call a predicate, like if p is a variable, but p is actually bound to, let's say, member, then I can call p. So it's kind of like reification. It lets us to call terms as they would be predicates. But as I said, the lecture notes cover all of this. So we have automatic detection of integers and floating point numbers, multiplication, division, addition and subtraction of numbers, integer division, modulo operation, basically the remainder of an integer division, less than, greater than, less than, equal, greater than, equal. Comparison between expressions after both expressions are evaluated, both for equality and for non-equality. So in the lecture notes, you will find a lot of algorithms, which may be useful for your homeworks, basically quicksort. So quicksort is a standard sorting algorithm. It sorts a list of elements. In the base case, sorting the empty list is the empty list. In the recursive case, sorting a list that has at least one element x0 first partitions that list into the elements that are less than x0 and greater than x0, sorts the less elements into a list ys1, sorts the greater elements into a list ys2, and then appends the list ys1 with the list that starts with x0 and has as a tail ys2 and gives us the sorted elements. So basically it sorts the elements less than x0, greater than x0, concatenates them, and now we have the entire sorted list. The partition predicate is a helper predicate. We get a pivot and the list. If the list is empty, then the less elements and the greater elements are both empty. Otherwise, we keep, if the head of the list x is less than the pivot, then we put it in the less elements and we call recursively partition the rest of the tail of that list x s with the same pivot into the tail ys of the less elements and in the greater elements. And if x is greater than the pivot, it puts x in the rest, in the greater elements, and partitions the tail into less and greater elements. Now we can see the first use of cut. So in the previous case, we had to write two conditions. If x is less than pivot, and if x is greater than pivot. I can avoid calling the second comparison if I put a cut. The cut basically says if x is less than pivot, then I will partition the rest of the elements into less and greater, but I will never backtrack. So I will only succeed and that's it. If x is not less than pivot, then I never reach this pruning. So it will just go to the second case. And now I don't need to put a condition anymore, this condition. It just knows that I got here because this failed to execute. This is called a red cut. That's why I colored it with red. Basically, it says that if somebody deletes that cut, then my program is not correct anymore. It will actually return the correct sorting, but through backtracking, it will backtrack and also give me sorts that are not actually sorted because it will even in the case that x was less than the pivot, it will give me these things too. So cut will basically prune, if it's present, the rest of the executions. Okay. It's there are people that say that cut is bad in all cases. I'm on the other hand, I'm saying that cut is good when you know how to use it. Okay. It's if you think imperatively, cut is good because you can actually use it to make your program more efficient. Stops the flow from backtracking. So I will show you an example because I have a better example later. Here is a better example. So let's assume that in the database I have P of A and P of B, and Q of A, Q of B, and Q of C. And I call P of X and cut. That basically succeeds only once for x equal with a, because it succeeds P of A, then the cut tells me do not backtrack. So never backtrack before the cut. But you can backtrack after the cut. So P of X cut Q of Y succeeds with P x equal a, but and then it returns Y could be A, or could be B, or could be C. But it doesn't backtrack past the cut. So it will not backtrack here, so it doesn't give me more answers. It doesn't give me actually the Cartesian product of A and B with A, B, C. It only gives me, it only backtracks to the right of the cut. It doesn't backtrack to the left of the cut. Any questions? Okay. It's useful in many cases. Like, for instance, it's useful here. We will see that it's useful in many, many different cases. Okay. So let's return here. Okay. So I have another predicate, delete. Delete deletes from an element from a list. And again, the basic case is that deleting the first element of a list is the tail of that list. Deleting an element from a list, if that element is not the first element of the list, I should keep the first element of the list, and then delete x from the tail of the first list, of the list, and we get the tail of the second list. So for instance, if I call delete s from the list that contains list, deletes s, and I get the list that contains lit. And then if I say delete x from the list, give me the list z, gives me pairs. It says if x is l, then the result is ist. If x is I, then the result is lst. If x is s, then the result is lit, and so on, four results. What about if I say delete s from what list gives me lit? It actually says, it inserts s back into this list and says that it could have been that this list from which we deleted s is s lit, or it could be that it was between l and I, or it could be that it was between li and t, or it could have been that it was at the end. So again, gives me all the possibilities one by one. So it can be used not only for deleting, but also for inserting in every position an element back into a list. And why is that important? Because it helps me to write other predicates much concise than I would do it in other languages. It has more power than other languages. Like, for instance, when I was teaching Computer Science 1, I asked my students to write a permutation in Java that returns all the permutations of a list of any type of objects. And I don't kid you, it was basically a homework that the students took a week to implement. And it's not that difficult. You have to return an array list of elements of objects. So Basically, this can be done in literally four lines in Prolog, two rules. How? You have to see what is the recursive case. So permutation would return recursively every permutation of a list. But for that, we have to see what is the relation between the permutations of the list and the permutations of the tail of that list. So if the list was 1, 2, 3, first, what we do, we eliminate the first element. So the permutations of 1, 2, 3 are the permutations of 2, 3, where we insert 1 into every position in the permutations of 2, 3. So permuting 2, 3 will return 2, 3, and 3, 2. And now permuting 1, 2, 3 would be 1 before 2, 3, 1 between 2, 3, and 1 after, and 1 before 3, 2, between and after. So now, the permutation of the empty list is the empty list. The permutation of a list that starts with the head X and the tail XS is the list YS. If permuting the tail XS is ZS, and deleting X from the result list gives me ZS. So delete will basically insert now X back into those permutations at every possible position to give me all the permutations. So I get, through backtracking, all the solutions. Yes? Not a problem. It will basically, it's like in the case of delete, if there are multiple instances, if I want to delete S from a list that contains multiple time X, S, it returns every one by one the first occurrence, and then the returns me the rest of the list. Deletes the second occurrence, returns the answer of the list. It's the same with permutations. If I permute a list of 1, 1, 1, it will return 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Basically, it treats the elements as they would be different. If I want sets, that's a very good question. For that, I would use an aggregate. So if I want, let me skip directly to aggregates. If I want to run a goal, like permute, and get all the results which I have unique instances of those results in the set, then I call set off, run this goal, and give me all the unique answers. So let me show you an example because this is useful. For instance, I have a predicate P of two arguments, P11, P12, and P21. And I want to find every occurrence of the second element. So a find all will call this predicate and will collect 1, 2, 1. If I want only unique occurrences, I can call set off. That will basically get rid of duplicates. There is a third predicate called bagOff, and there is a fourth predicate, tfindAll, but in most cases you are going to use the first two predicates. This is useful for, like for instance, group by in databases. I want to return for every student the courses that that student takes. You can think of this predicate like this would be the student and these are the courses that that student takes. Then I would use a bagOff. I would say X is the student, and I want to return for every student the courses that he takes. It basically groups on the variable that only occurs for the first time in that predicate that I have the goal, and I don't collect it in the result. It's like group by this variable and return both that the grouping variable and the list of values. Okay. Any questions? Good. So I think another issue that is important, I will skip difference lists. So difference lists is an optimization feature. Basically, what they are used for, I will just show you here. In this one slide is enough. It basically says, if you want to add an element at the end of a list, in Prolog, it will take you basically the length of that list because it has to check the first element. It has to basically iterate to the end of the list to add the element and then add the rest of the elements back to the list. But what if we keep a variable at the end of the list? Then all I have to do to add an element is to assign to that variable. So here I have a variable y, and now I can say y is 4 followed by z. And now the original list x is 1, 2, 3, 4 followed by the variable z. So a difference list is basically a way to access the rest of the list. So we end the list with a variable, and we pass, in addition to the list, that variable. It's kind of incomplete data structure. They are very useful for efficient predicates, but most programmers in Prolog don't use them. So this would be, in your case, I think, just information overload. So let's skip it. What I think that it will be important for you, for any program that you would write, is graph manipulation. So I will spend a little bit of time on graph manipulation. So for instance, how do we store a graph in Prolog? There are multiple ways. One is to store it as facts, like edges that are stored as facts in database. And if we have isolated nodes, then we would also add facts for the nodes. So it will tell us that A, B, C, D are nodes, and there are edges from A to B, B to C, and so on. Or we store the entire, we pass from predicate to predicate the entire data structure as a structure, basically a graph functor with two arguments, the list of nodes and the list of edges. Or as an adjacency list. It basically a list of every single node and its destinations. You can consider any one of these representations. The most popular representation is the middle one that basically considers that the graph is a predicate graph with the nodes and the edges. So a few interesting predicates would be to find the paths from every node to what nodes can be reached. Another predicate is to, let's find all the nodes that are in a cycle or the cycles in the graph. If you need to implement Pac-Man, for instance, you can represent it as a graph. Every position in Pac-Man is basically a node, and it has the neighbors, unless there is a wall. And then you can represent the entire Pac-Man as a graph. And now, let's say that those ghosts that are running after Pac-Man are basically finding the shortest path, to this Pac-Man. You would need a predicate path that takes that graph, takes two nodes, like the position of a ghost and the position of Pac-Man, and finds a path from the node A to the node B in that graph. So first thing you have to decide if this graph that you have is directed or undirected. In this case, I basically just implement another level on top of the graph. We can directly go from X to Y if there is an edge from X to Y in the graph set of edges. Remember that the internal representation for the graph is a binary predicate with the nodes as the first argument and the list of edges as the second argument. So if there is an edge from X to Y in the graph, then basically those two vertices are neighbors. If I consider, in addition to the edges from X to Y, the edges from Y to X, then basically this is an undirected graph. Now, path can be written in two predicates. There is a path from A to B. If I can find a path to the path that ends in B. So what this does, it actually does finds path from the end to the beginning. So if the helper predicate says, if in my graph I found a path from A to this path that starts with A, that means that I found a path. Basically, I started from B and I went backwards until I reached A. And I return it. So yeah, that's the path. Otherwise, in that graph, I want to find the path to the current path that the current node is y. If there is an edge from x to y, I also inquire if x was not already seen in that path, so I don't go into infinite loops. And then I call, give me also if try to find now a path from a to x. So my current path is x, y, and the rest of the path p1. So what this does, it actually finds paths from the end to the beginning. Initially, I basically have in the path only the last node, but then I look at nodes that go to that node, nodes that go to those nodes, and finally I stop when I basically found the entire path. Any questions? I think it's a really cool predicate. And now if I want to find the cycle, it's quite easy. I want to find cycles from A. Excellent. I look at the neighbors from A. Let's say B is a neighbor of A. And now I look for a path from B to A. And finally, the cycle is the list that starts with A and has that path from B to A. So I basically get A, then B, and the path back to A. And the entire program is here. Basically, it has a directed graph, the implementation of path, the implementation of cycle, and this is an example. Give me cycles that start from A. So for instance, such a cycle would be A, B, B, C, and C goes back to A. And it always terminates because this also has this not member. So actually this is something new that you haven't seen before. So let's actually go to it. I had not somewhere. Give me a second. Negation. So slash plus. So this backward slash was used for difference. Backward slash equal means those two things are not equal. Backward slash plus means that is not positive. So what happens if basically I call a predicate, if it has no solutions, then not that predicate returns true. If it has solutions, then not of that predicate returns false. So really what this operator is negation as failure. If I fail to prove that predicate, then I succeed. If I prove that predicate, then I fail. In XSB, there are other negations. Table negation, which is T naught. Not itself is a negation, which I didn't include it here, which in most cases is equivalent with slash plus. Okay. Any questions? That's all for today. Thank you very much for attending.